action.
Thank you, Dan. Welcome, everyone. Just a couple of notices. First, the observant of you will notice that there's an extra hymn. So we're going to sing a communion hymn when you get back to your place in the pew. Alleluia, sing to Jesus, that is. So that gives Georgie and I time to do the washing up and walking back down here for the post-communion prayer. And I know you're a really observant lot. I did get O-level maths, but my calculation is very wrong when I put in Graham and Mirabel's 60th wedding anniversary. We're not 33 years apart, I think it was 37. Someone please tell me afterwards. So, without further ado, the Lord be with you. Let's sing our first hymn, which is hymn number 163.
The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself.
There is no other commandment greater than this. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Let us sit on you and just take a few moments to reflect. And we pray, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our undeliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We stand for the glory of God.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. You shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, Here I am. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom be like the noonday. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your needs in parched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water, whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt. You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live in. If you refrain from trampling the Sabbath, from pursuing your own interests on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the holy day of the Lord honorable, if you honor it, not going your own ways, serving your own interests, or pursuing your own affairs, then you shall take delight in the Lord. And I will make you ride upon the heights of the earth. I will feed you with the heritage of your ancestor Jacob. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from a letter to the Hebrews. You have not come to something that can be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom, and a tempest and the sound of a trumpet, and a voice whose words make the hearers beg, that not another word be spoken to them. For they could not endure the order that was given. Even if an animal touches the mountain, it shall be stoned to death. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion, and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to the innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse the one who is speaking. For if they do not escape when they refuse the one who warned them on earth, how much less will we escape if we reject the one who warns from heaven? At that time his voice shook the earth, and now he has promised, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heaven. This phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of what is shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us give thanks, by which we offer to God an acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for indeed our God is coming, is a consuming fire. This is the word of the Lord.
Shall we stand and sing hymn 166, Lord, thy word abideth.
Thank you.
verses 10 to 17. Now he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hand on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on these days and be cured, and not on the day of Sabbath." But the Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May my words and our thoughts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. This little story that George just read for us gets to the heart of Jesus' mission in Luke, certainly. You may recall when Jesus laid out that mission in chapter 4 of Luke, when he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight and blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the Lord, the year of the Lord's favour." There is hardly an episode in Luke that does not point back to this amazing messianic manifesto, and this week's reading is no exception. This theme of liberation has particular relevance as Jesus insists that the woman with the bad back, the bent over woman, is set free. She's released from her bond. So powerful is this point made that Jesus goes so far as to talk about the devil being responsible for such a painful and debilitating illness which imprisons the woman. I suspect we all know how frustrating it is to be ill, how it takes away our freedom to do what we'd ordinarily find easy. It can indeed be a bit like being tied up. And in the COVID era, of course, while a bit melodramatic, we could justifiably say that we have all, at some stage, been imprisoned in our own homes due to illness. Less dramatically, perhaps, whether it's your arm in plaster or an inability to stop coughing, all you want to be is free from pain and inconvenience on your body and able to go about life again in comfort. When Jesus debates with the synagogue leader about the Sabbath law, he draws directly from a piece of Deuteronomy, which is a version which connects the commandment to Israel's liberation. This is the bit. "Remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and that the Lord your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day." It's about liberation. And we also heard in the Old Testament reading of Jeff read for us how the Sabbath is to be honoured and called a delight, but only if it is never used for selfish gain. In Jesus' view, then, since the Sabbath law commemorates and celebrates the liberation of Israel, it ought to be a day for action, not reticence. Thus his passion for the present-day liberation of the Israelites, including women with bad backs. Furthermore, he cites the custom of providing water for thirsty livestock on the Sabbath, proving that surely it's more appropriate to heal a long-suffering Israelite on the Sabbath, if we are prepared to help even our farm animals. Nowhere does Jesus abolish the Sabbath commandment. Quite the contrary, he aims to follow it faithfully. Jesus enters what was at that time an ongoing Jewish debate about how to interpret the Sabbath law, locating himself at the less stringent end of the spectrum, let's say. But this is more than a debate about scriptural interpretation. It is more fundamentally one of those instances of God's kingdom breaking into the present world to do good, not to be constrained by human-made rules and customs. Our gospel reading really should not end where it does, because Jesus continues in the next verse saying, "What is the kingdom of God like?" And he says it's a tiny mustard seed that grows into a tree. There are similarities, believe it or not, between this bent over woman and the mustard seed. Something seemingly small and insignificant becomes, with God's loving and transforming power, a vessel to further God's kingdom. When he laid his hands upon her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. I want to emphasize seemingly small and insignificant, to highlight Jesus' distinctive messianic vision. Jesus sees and cherishes what others might overlook, people who others might overlook. And that vision extends to the church's ministry as well. We can't simply blame Jesus' culture in imagining the woman's social invisibility or her perceived insignificance. The same can happen in our society today, and we certainly know only too well the disparities between different peoples, and in fact between men and women too, when you think of things like pay difference. For 18 years, the woman has been quite unable to stand up straight, meaning that she's been unable to look people in the eye. Her vision has been limited to the ground in front of her. Likewise, her community's view of her has been limited to her bent over back and the top of her head. Yet Jesus spots the mustard seed. He sees the woman in a way no one else does and calls her forward. He doesn't take her into a side room for a private healing, but engages her and heals her in front of everybody. This then allows her, for the first time in 18 years, to praise God face to face with the rest of her community. And with the woman's restoration comes the restoration of the community. Her neighbours now see her more fully. By strengthening the woman to see them, Jesus grants her a fuller vision of the woman, so that in the end, the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. Posture here is symbolic of being fully human, standing tall and able to see clearly and be clearly seen. I can't but help think of the service celebrating the life of the dance teacher, the late Miss Guy, with all her former students, some of them in their 70s and 80s, sitting Rambert Street or standing beautifully in the chapel of the Creme where her funeral took place. But none of this is to say that the woman's bent over condition had compromised the validity of her life or her worship. The story doesn't question at all the sacred worth of people who are differently abled. But it's used symbolically to emphasize Jesus' power to make people whole once again. Being differently abled is sometimes experienced as brokenness, but it may also be experienced as something to be honoured and celebrated. And we need in this church to honour the spectrum of differently abled experience, as I believe we do actually every Sunday. The woman's brokenness does not reduce differently abled people to the broken. Finally, it is worth reflecting that Jesus' mission to heal, his mission for our lives, never waits for an allegedly more appropriate day. bent over woman must be straightened on the Sabbath, then human healing can happen at any time. Perhaps a message for me and my own occasionally lackadaisical way of doing things, that the kingdom of God does not accommodate our sense of propriety and polite timing. It is God's will to heal and to build the kingdom, not tomorrow, not next week, not next year. Stand to confess our faith in the words of the Creed.
We believe in one God,
the Father of all mankind,
maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only Son of God,
its only begotten of the Father,
God from God,
light from light,
true God from true God,
begotten not made,
of one being with the Father.
Through him all things were made.
For us, our salvation,
he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit, and the Virgin Mary,
and was made man.
For our sake, he was crucified on the cross of Christ.
He suffered death and was buried.
On the third day he rose again,
according to the Scriptures.
And is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory
to judge the living and the dead,
and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life,
who receives from the Father and the Son,
who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified,
who has spoken to the prophets.
We believe in one
Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church.
We acknowledge
all baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead
and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
We sit on you for the prayers of intercession. Let us pray. In peace, let us pray to Jesus, our Saviour, who ever lives to make intercession for us. Lord of the Church, empower by your Spirit all Christian people and the work of your Church in every land. Give us grace to proclaim the Gospel joyfully, in word and deed. May human rules, conventions never stop us from loving our neighbours as you love us. Lord, in your mercy, Saviour of the world, be present in all places of suffering, violence and pain, and bring hope in the darkest night. Inspire us to continue your work of reconciliation in the world today. Lord, in your mercy, Shepherd and guardian of our souls, guide and enable all who lead and serve this community and those on whom we depend for our daily needs. We pray for those who keep us safe, those who make us well, and those who serve society selflessly. Grant that all may seek and find peace and support in our community. Lord, in your mercy. Great Physician, stretch out your hand to bring comfort, wholeness and peace to all who suffer in body, mind or spirit. We call to mind especially those on our prayer list in the pew leaflet. We remember Ray Kitchen, David Bishop, Ed Churchill, Audrey Filson, Katie and Mark Sarkoff, Baby Finn, Sophie and the family, Desi and John Campbell, Mike and Daphne Noel, Tanda and the twins, David and Sonia Parker, Linda Mollick, Carol Chanel, and Rach Kruger. Let us just remember those personally known to us in a few moments.
Lord, in your mercy. Fill us with compassion that we may be channels of your healing love. Conqueror of death, remember for good those whom we love but see no longer. Help us to live this day in sure and certain hope of your eternal victory. Amongst those who have died recently, we especially remember now John Oliver O'Connor, Mary Richards, and James William English. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
We stand for the peace. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. We offer one another a sign of peace. So we're going to sing our next hymn, our offertory hymn, Stand Up and Bless the Lord, hymn number 201, 201.
Be with you.
to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will, and won for you our holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious fame, forever praising you and singing. share in the body of Christ.
first and last verses of hymn number
2 Six. Pilgrimage, you have willed that the gate of mercy should stand open for those who trust in you. Look upon us with your favor, that we who follow the path of your will may never wander from the way of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray together the prayer after communion. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
We stand to sing our final hymn, hymn number 205.
Thank you.
understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you this day and forevermore. Before I ask Sylvie to dismiss us, hey, Janet. So, some of us were lucky enough to see Janet's medal. Are you still wearing it? Great. Okay, no, not today. Last week she wore a splendid medal, and it was to do with her reading, and she's been given a certificate. Gadgeteers is the group. And she is now a gadgeteer because I think of all the amazing reading she's been doing. So I think a little round of applause is beautiful. Well done, Jack. We're very proud of you. Well done. Brilliant. Right.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.